As well as the costs associated with a potentially high reserve.
Yes.
And that's going to cost us $700,000.
If we retain the benefits we have today, if we do as the chairman suggests and adjust benefits, then that number would be adjusted down.
You don't have that slide on your machine, do you, from last month?
Definitely not. I've got it. What I... Is it?
That deficit brings us back to where we were with the increased premiums too. On slides. I think all the other stuff we can kind of deal with except specials. It's kind of just sky's the limit on that.
Oh, that's so.
Where's Tony? Is he here today?
Right there.
Tony? Maybe Tony shed some light. Can you shed some light, Tony? On what we were just discussing on our current plan and the plan changes they had proposed initially.
The initial 18.6%, we negotiated down to 4.2, which was with some of the things that you were talking about the deductible that you didn't like. And I don't quite remember what the changing that deductible back to a copay was, or that may have been the one that brought it back to 5.2%. But I will say that your assessment, you talk about the self-funding, if we were to go with self-funding and go with Blue Choice now, that would still give us leeway to, as we go through the next year, to say, okay, let's look at, do we want to put it out to bid and look at other TPAs, or are we pleased with this network? You know, certainly we need to establish the reserve, but, you know, as you said, we pay about $1 million a month. So, you know, that would, that reserve would be if we were to, you know, the run out as you were talking about. So, you know, I think even if we were to go with Blue Choice and self-fund July 1, because that does leave the current plan design intact. And, you know, so employees would be very familiar with the plan design. They wouldn't see any changes pretty much, but, you know, it would just be how we pay. That's the difference. Yes, you were about to say something.
Tony, I want to ask you about that. So you think we could go self-insured July 1, and what I'm looking at is trying to save that $700,000 and also don't put us out to be exposed to a $3 or $4 million loss. I mean, do you think we have that exposure? I mean, with your, what you know about self-insurance?
You know, there's always that chance, but when you look at a $3 or $4 million exposure, are we going to have a massive number of employees who are either going to have premature babies or major surgeries or whatever that, you know, because when you look at that aggregate number, because that's, if that specific is set at 125, then, you know, our liability is 125,000. Well, if you look at the information that was presented about the claims over 125,000, that I had gotten that information from Blue Choice, and I think, and I'm trying to think, with the exception of this year, that $800,000 or almost $1 million claim, then the next one dropping down was like 300 and something, and then even in previous years, I don't think we had but a few claims that were over $300,000. So the point I'm making is that it would be a major disaster that we would have to get to, say, $4 million a month. We'd have to have a lot of serious claims. You know, it's always a chance, but the likelihood of that happening, you know, if there had to be some major disaster with our employee base. And so To get to that point, probably we would, you know, it would be difficult to get that point. So I don't see, I don't think it's an over risk. I think we could possibly do that, and then that would give us breathing room to look at: are we pleased with what we have here? Do we want to negotiate more with Blue Choice, or do we want to look at putting out to bid for another TPA that is going to have a good network? Because at least we've got Blue Choice's network behind us at this particular time. And if we self-fund, we've got Blue Choice's network behind us at that particular time. But that would give us a chance to see if other TPAs even have that kind of network. And that way, that puts less on our employees in terms of having to go find other providers and that kind of thing. Yes, sir.
Can't we buy also reinsurance beyond that 125? Couldn't we buy a stop loss for a $2 million policy? If we were scared about getting a $4 million, and that's pretty cheap stuff, because I think that's what we do.
Well, what we have is we have the aggregate stop loss. We'll have two stop losses, specific or an individual claim and an aggregate. The problem with the aggregate stop loss, if I can use that
term, that's worst case scenario.
Worst case scenario, right. That's the worst case scenario because, you know, it's a moving target. You know, they set at 125% of your anticipated claims. So if they anticipate your claims are going to be $12 million this month, then you've got to hit that point, that moving target. As they get claims experience and they anticipate next month, it's going to be 11.5, that's a lower target. So it's a moving target, but the likelihood of that happening again, you're going to have a major, major amount of claims. And you're talking about even the, I think when Jim showed the claims over 125,000 for the year, you know, you didn't have $4 million in 1 year, and just all of a sudden, so even if those claims had all been in 1 month, we still would have hit that number that you're talking about.
You found that slide, Jim?
No, sir.
Okay.
Good. Sorry.
Well, Tony, was that correct about the five point something percent, and then by changing to a deductible versus copay on the specialist, you got it to 4 point some odd. Can you elaborate?
Well, the 4.2 came before, from 18.6 to 4.2.
Oh, okay.
And then I think Ms. Hall expressed concern about, and maybe a couple of others expressed concern about not having a specialist copay. And so I believe that's where that an additional amount rolled in. I believe if I'm
so what is that figure to get the copay back in on the specialist? Do you know?
I think that's the plan that everyone chimed in about last week that they wanted to keep that copay in for the specialist, and I would say that would also happen if we went self-funded, we would still have that specialist copay. In fact, the current benefit structure would be in place, so you would have that specialist copay that was $50, and the primary care would still be at $35, I believe. So that's what would happen.
So from your standpoint, should we stay as is for 6 months and change in January, or should we go ahead now and go self-funded if we want to with Blue Choice?
I would say self-fund.
Okay. And I would concur, if you're not seriously wanting to look further at the state plan, I think Tony's giving you the right answer.
Well, the only thing I'll say about, you know, being in a business with a Blue Cross or Blue Choice network is because they insure about 50% of the people in the entire state, when they go to negotiate with regional Mary Black and other hospitals, and they command a bigger discount. So when you as a patient go to the hospital and you're in the hospital and you're on your deductible and co-insurance, it saves you money in the long run. Not to say the other networks aren't good, but they just don't quite get that discount. So, but I mean, there's no reason that if you go with self-funded now, you can't shop it for next year to another TPA.
Right.
Maybe get that $8 down to $6 or something like that, or whatever. Then is that what you're saying?
Right. That's okay. Right.
You just got to come up with a figure to fund reserve and fund run out if we do change next year. Is what you've got to do. So you've got a year to, you know, come up with that particular amount. So in other words, you can go ahead and self-fund right now, keep the same plan for the employees. From what I saw, you were going to pass on for at least a year a little bit of a lower cost out of pocket, out of our paychecks for that, or is that correct?
No change.
I want to hear a little bit more about the $706,000 that we're talking about. If we self-fund starting July 1.
Yeah, if you self-fund starting January 1, there will be some expense to the county if we chose to go that route.
But if we self-fund?
If we self-fund July 1, that expense will go away.
Well, I tell you what I would do if we do it. I think we should start July 1. I'll concur with Tony. I think we take some of that $700,000 we potentially could expend and buy some serious self, excess insurance or whatever, get one of these consultants to tell us what to get so we don't have that $3 or $4 million exposure. We buy, I think it's $35,000. Isn't that what, I think that's what our CFO told us.
Yes, sir.
So you spend $35,000, buy you a big policy, cover anything like that, it'd be money well spent.
How many employees do you have?
800. And we've got 1,281 here.
Yes.
We did have 1,200 when we were still doing it.
And we've got about 1.5 times.
Yeah, but at the time, up until 08, we laid off a lot in 09 and 10. We had the same numbers we have now, and we've been self-insured for 10, 15 years. And we have saved, because we used to do the same thing, a couple million dollars.
To me, the bonus with self-insurance is the fact that we can develop wellness programs and offer incentives for wellness that we have not been able to truly do in the past. Plus, I like the idea that we can also choose, like, some of the preventive things and diagnostics that we do, like colonoscopies, mammograms, things of that sort. We can kind of lead our own way with that. Is that correct?
Yes.
So for that reason, I see much more flexibility and much more that we can offer our employee than what we're doing right now. I choose that we go self-funded July 1.
I agree. I go back to what Chairman Horton, the comment he made about Blue Choice being the largest insurer in the state right now. Yes, I do feel like that we should constantly be looking for, a better program. I don't see that waiting 6 months that we're going to actually find a better program.